Vamos a comenzar con esta segunda jornada del tercer Congreso Internacional de Derechos Humanos y Justicia Climática, organizado, como bien saben, por la Fundación Mainel y la Fundación Promoción Social. Bienvenidos, bienvenidas todos a esta jornada, que va a ser intensa y estamos seguros de que tan interesante como lo fue la de ayer. Y abrimos el programa hoy con la ponencia, con la participación del doctor Linus Mattauch, al cual voy a presentar brevemente. Linus es un economista con experiencia en política sobre clima, política climática, economía, desigualdad en la riqueza y el bienestar. Actualmente es investigador senior en el Institute for New Economic Thinking de la Universidad de Oxford y profesor en el Instituto de Cambio Ambiental. Sus investigaciones se han centrado en evaluar las opciones políticas para mitigar el cambio climático y también para abordar la desigualdad en el reparto de la riqueza. Una parte importante de su trabajo se ha dedicado a mostrar que un impuesto sobre el carbono podría ser una solución efectiva y hasta popular entre los ciudadanos y para beneficiar a los hogares de pocos ingresos, pero ha trabajado sobre toda una serie de distintas líneas de investigación. Ha publicado en Science, cosa que no todo el mundo puede decir, y en toda una serie de otras revistas internacionales. Él es de origen alemán, aunque casi toda su formación y su trayectoria académica se ha desarrollado en el Reino Unido. Y me complace particularmente decir que también que su formación inicial era en matemáticas y en filosofía, lo cual demuestra que los de letras también podemos hacer cosas bastante interesantes en este campo. Y sin más, le cedo la palabra. Linus.
Good morning. Thank you very much for the kind introduction and the invitation. It's my pleasure to be here. So I was asked to speak on what's the economics of climate change, very basically, but to subdivide and say what is it that the economics of climate change can tell us it is needed and what is it that is possible. Now, you know, some of you might think that because I'm an economist, I might not say that, you know, climate change, is it all that
wait,
urgent?
Wait. It looks like there is a problem with the microphone.
Test? Okay, excellent. So thank you again. I'm meant to speak on the economics of climate change, and in particular about what is needed and what is possible here. Now, you may think, well, he's an economist. Maybe he doesn't think climate change is all that serious, or is there all that urgent? No, very much like in our research, we understand it's a very urgent problem, and so I understand the slogan of the Fridays for Future movement, if you like, who say unite behind the science as follows, to do some sort of translation into the economics. Whatever your view, what kind of climate target is the accurate one? And however you translate that into the limited space there is for emissions in the atmosphere, it's very clear that this is the essence of the problem, that there's very limited space in the atmosphere to put in further CO2 emissions to limit to avoid dangerous climate change, and there's far more the space is far more limited than the fossil resources which are underground, which makes climate change in that sense an economic problem, because economics is the science of scarce resources. So we have a very scarce limited disposal space in the atmosphere. This is how the economists would understand the idea of unite behind the science, whatever your specific problem on a climate target. And so we're faced with this very limited disposal space to deliver on the Paris Agreement and avoid the unmanageable risk from climate change. And that's my point of departure here, and just sort of to spoil you and give you the main message is, what do I believe in two sentences? What is it that is needed, and then what is it that is possible? So what the economics tells us, what is needed to achieve, say, well below 2 degrees, is a rapid transformation of the energy and also the land use system, and for that we need a high growth in renewable energy. But we also need a combination of risky and partially speculative technologies, as I'll detail throughout the next 45 minutes or so. And our basic and perhaps the most central finding from that literature in economics that tells you what's needed is that the transformation of that of the energy system should come at a minor cost, at a small cost, compared to the avoided climate damages. So the cost of transforming the energy system is very low compared to the cost you would have from unmitigated climate change to societies. So that's what's needed. What's possible, given the situation in economics and political economy, say, and I'll say something if there's some philosophers in the room how that's to be interpreted later. So the basic message is here that yes, the most efficient instrument to reduce emissions is a carbon price. And while there are concerns that a carbon price might harm the poor people, it can actually be made progressive. So it can be designed so that the poor people benefit. And then there are ways, as I'm going to detail, how a carbon price, a carbon price can be made more popular. A carbon price can be made more popular with citizens in combination with other instruments. So that's the very basic summary. That's what I'm going to have to say for the next 45 minutes or so. So let's start. And start with the part about what is needed. The part what's needed is studied by our literature, a stream of research that's called integrated assessment modeling. And an integrated assessment model is a model in economics that combines some aspects of what's desirable, so welfare, with some aspect, some modeling of the physical system, the climate system, but also some model of the energy system, and finally the economy, the macroeconomic implications. And with such a model, and there are many around in the world, you can study questions such as how can we limit warming to 2 degrees or 1.5 degrees about pre-industrial, and how much warming would be optimal, which is a different question. And these models can tell you something about what's the least cost way, say, to achieve such a target, which translates to net zero emissions in 2050, or what's the relationship also with other environmental problems, such as biodiversity conservation or land use. So these are the kind of questions you can study in economics with these models. And it's important, I like to stress, that they're, of course, benchmark models. They're not meant to be a forecast. They're meant to tell us something about what ought to be done to manage climate change optimally. And they're typically global models, although there's sometimes disaggregation into world regions. Now, with this tool, this is a stylized representation, you're meant to basically answer the following question. Sort of don't take the numbers literally, this is just schematic. There's a gap here between what we would see without any climate policy and where we would like to go to deliver on the climate targets. So these models are meant to provide answers. How do we get there from what's to be expected if there's no policy to what's desirable? And then an answer could look like something like that. So they would tell you what is the proportion of how much of the emission reductions are meant to come from different mitigation options. So one important option in yellow is evidently renewable energy. Another important option in blue is energy efficiency programs. Things should get more energy efficient. And then there are sort of more contested options, such as, say, nuclear or carbon capture and storage, so the idea that at least for a while you could store carbon underground. I'll say something in more detail. This is just sort of to illustrate what kind of answer you would get from such models. And here I like to stress that in this way, economists often are sort of taken by the public to do forecasting. Well, these models are not forecasting what's going to happen in the next decade or so. In fact, economists of that strand, they act more like map makers. So that the map making analogy for these models is the right one. It's like economists who work on these problems, they try to provide politicians, policy makers, stakeholders with maps, what could be done, what kind of options are available to mitigate climate change under some constraints. So we're not talking about forecasts here, we're talking about giving some policy advice, what ought to be done, and what the trade-offs in this are. So that said, there are two very different and basic ways how you could answer such a question, what's needed, what ought to be done, which are basic to a lot of economic analysis, not just the economic of climate change. The first one is what's called a cost-effectiveness analysis. So in this context of this problem, you're asking the question, well, given there's a temperature target or an emission reduction target, what's the cost-effective, what's the cheapest way of achieving this target? And there's a second way to think about the problem, and that's what's called a cost-benefit analysis. You're weighing the costs and the benefits, and you study the trade-off, and you, if you're doing it in that way, then you'd like to answer the question, what's the optimal amount of global warming? How much warming is optimal? Because obviously, no warming can't be optimal given where we are now. So these are two very different ways of analyzing this problem. I now start with the first one, which is probably sort of the more natural one for you. And then I'll be briefer on the second class of results. So on the first one, this is basically coming from the picture I started with. So take a guardrail, you like, or another political language that's been established as a planetary boundary. And that's going to be determined outside the model, whether you know you like 2 degrees or 1.8 degree, and you'd like to, you can translate this climate target into the remaining budget there is for carbon emissions to be put into the atmosphere. And so this kind of method of cost-effectiveness analysis, what's the cheapest way with integrated assessment models, then calculates you the optimal way to achieve a climate target. What does it cost, and by which technologies do we get there? So perhaps the most basic result of that strand is the following, which, you know, sort of the major outcome of the large IPCC assessment cycle of 2013 is to say, well, it doesn't cost the world to save the planet. Climate change mitigation is not thought all that costly, at least if you have a look at the title, is not more costly than another area of a major policy reform. So if you think about, you know, what does it take to reform our health system, this transformation of the energy system comparatively is not on a different order of magnitude. So in that sense, we shouldn't be too worried that, you know, this transformation is going to be so costly to our societies. Still talking about, of course, what's optimal. So here I stress, because I said it's a cost-effectiveness analysis, if I'm talking about the cost, I've taken out the benefit out of avoiding unmanageable climate change. If just asking the question, suppose you want to get to 2 degrees, how much is it going to cost? Okay, so this is just, you know, for the moment, that's just a nice saying. What's behind that, that was sort of given the main message out of the last assessment of the IPCC Working Group 3, how much does it actually cost? I've brought you some numbers here. I hope then they're not too confusing. So sort of on a global scale, what this large assessment of a lot of studies conducted by this integrated assessment model is telling us is the following. If you think about global consumption, gross domestic product, GDP, then again, taking out the benefits, if you're thinking about how much does it cost to decarbonize the economy, then it's saying, well, in 2030, we'd have a loss in global consumption of 1% to 4%, and at the end of this century, something between 3% and 11%, so let's say 10%. So the economy would, at that stage, be 10% smaller than if we are living in the hypothetical world in which there wasn't any climate change and there was nothing to worry about. And that might sound like quite a lot, but then, you know, in these models there is also economic growth. So actually it isn't all that much, because it's saying, well, if you now take this loss of 10% of global economic output in 2100, then you translate that to the annual average, then the annual reduction of economic growth of consumption would only be something like 0.04 or 0.14 percentage point of lost growth per year over the century. So it's still a very small number if you're thinking about, you know, the global economy growing at something of perhaps 2% as a projection over the whole century. So, and indeed, what's said in this assessment is to say that the studies that come up with these numbers assume there is going to be global economic growth corresponding to increases in the total consumption by roughly a factor of 2 or even 4 in the next couple of decades. So these studies still assume the world economy is going to double or triple over the next couple of decades, and then the cost to transforming our energy system is going to be very, very small. Now, to you, that might not sound like a lot of news, but still I think this is a very important message to the public at large out there, to saying, well, doing all that transformation, the economists will tell you, won't cost all that much. So then the next obvious question here is then, well, if it doesn't cost all that much, how is it going to look like? So very stylized, as you know, I have a limited amount of time. I'm going to say something basic about what are the major changes to the energy system that are implicit in this kind of overall outcome. So the first and most important one is obviously a strong growth in renewable energy. Unfortunately, these overall messages from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, they have a certain reputation of producing very complicated graphs. So a lot of complicated diagrams here, so I'll try to show you just sort of the basics. So you can basically focus on the light blue here, because the light blue scenario is the one that corresponds to a 2-degree target. And then the others, which show higher emission concentrations. So this chart shows you the low carbon energy share, so the renewable share, if you like, of primary energy in the world economy. And it'll tell you, like, in 2020, we were at about 15% of renewable energy share, perhaps. And that tells you that to 2030, and then going all the way to 2050 and 2100, we need a strong growth in renewable energy share. So these projections assume that you solve climate change, you decarbonize the world economy, then in 2100, you want to have a low carbon energy share of your system of close to 90%. And you need strong growth rates of renewables. And without that, it's just not possible to solve climate change. But that's not saying it's all technology. So it's not saying just the technologies need to change and we're fine and we can get to 2 degrees. So in addition, there are important assumptions in these assessments that also we need better energy efficiency and we also need demand reductions in certain sectors of the economy. So again, complicated chart, focus on the light blue. The light blue is the projection for getting to 2 degrees. And so here you have various sectors of the economy. You have the transport sector, the building sector, and the emissions from the industry. And this shows you that the given reduction in energy demand in these sectors. So I'm sorry, there should be some numbers here, which should say 2030 and 2050. I'm sorry that the numbers are lacking. But what it is telling you is that, say, in 2050, if you focus on this, our transport sector globally should have a demand reduction in energy consumption of 30%, if you take this as the kind of the mean value. And similarly, for buildings, a little bit less. For buildings and industry, perhaps in 2050, you want the global economy, although it is growing, to consume 25% less energy in these sectors. And now, this is including, say, a change in consumption patterns. So, you know, energy demand reduction in transport, you would certainly get that from people driving less of a car. Even it's not saying the car should be powered by electric. The car should be electric. It's saying, well, there should be less energy in the transport system. So there are these important assumptions on also that we need a demand reduction. It's not all about technological solutions in these optimal assessments. And then finally, to give you a glimpse, a broad overview, what this subject is doing, this is perhaps the most complicated chart. Then there are, of course, some speculative technologies which have achieved a great deal of attention in the public, which you may also need to achieve net zero emissions, to achieve the full decarbonization. So again, this is sort of roughly studying a scenario with to achieve limiting warming to 2 degrees. And you have here the different sectors. Again, you have transport, you have building, you have industry, you have electricity. And so this shows you the direct net emissions. So you're seeing here in particular that so that the emissions from the electricity sector later on in this century should be negative. Again, these are 3 points in time. So the question is, how could our electricity sector, our power sector, produce negative emissions in a couple of decades? The idea is sort of what's called to combine carbon capture and storage. So you suck carbon out of the atmosphere, or when you burn it in the power sector, and put it underground with some bioenergy use, because in that sense you can generate negative emissions if you you farm a lot of bioenergy crops. You use those for producing energy,
And then you store the carbon underground, you would effectively plug carbon out of the atmosphere. So what this chart is now trying to show you is that, well, that's a speculative technology that's perhaps risky and not appreciated by society. So the left chart shows you the path to 2 degrees with that technology, while the right chart shows you, well, if we can get to 2 degrees if we're not having that technology, if it's without carbon capture and storage. But then it shows you, this is the land use sector, it's afforestation and land use, is what that means, and that shows you strong negative emissions. So it's mean, well, we don't need to do CCS, but then at least for 2 degrees, we need to do a lot of afforestation around the world on a scale that's, again, seems very risky. So it's showing that while getting to 2 degrees is possible technologically, economically, there's still some hard choices here for the world. Imagine what that's going to do in terms of managing the risk around biodiversity and other environmental problems related to land use. So while, yes, it's possible, it's not very costly, you have these hard trade-offs, and you need social deliberation how to deal with these trade-offs. So this is, I think, what I have to say on the part of the cost-effectiveness analysis. What's needed? How do we get to just 2 degrees? It's just one more point which I wanted to drive home. These models also give you what would be the required carbon price to achieve these targets. So you can read off from these models what's the, say, the tax you want to levy on emissions if you want to get to these targets. So again, the light blue here is the scenario of achieving 2 degrees of warming. So this would tell you that in 2020, say you'd need a global carbon price of around $50, and which then grows to $100 in 2030, up to $1,000 in 2100. And you want it, you know, in this stylized experiment of what's optimal to have such a price on all of the global emissions. I'll spend the second half of the lecture talking about the political realities and the problems with that. I'm just saying that sort of this is what comes out of these models as an optimal carbon price. And then, of course, if you're very keen to say, well, 2 degrees isn't enough, we want to get to, for reasons that climate change is turning out to be ever more severe, if we want to get to not 2 degrees, but 1.5 degrees, and the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, has also produced a report about that last year. Again, it's sort of basically the same kind of, ignore the text, it's basically the same kind of answer. Well, we need to reduce emissions very fast, and in the second half of the century, they need to be negative, and that depends on your assumptions about how much economic growth there is, how successful we are in reducing energy demand patterns. So the conclusion is here that an even more stringent mitigation target, if you want to get to 1.5 degrees, is not yet, as they put it, geophysically impossible. The world could get to 1.5 degrees, but the benefits over the 2 degrees, and that they would be substantial, and here I agree with the natural scientists, you know, it'll be much better if we could do that. But the economics of that is that the cost is very hard to quantify. So in some sense, we don't know properly whether 1.5 degrees would be optimal, just because the economics isn't yet there to say, well, the cost of getting to 1.5 degrees over 2 degrees is also going to be enormous. And so then, in a way, you're back to this other kind of analysis where you're asking, well, how much warming is optimal? So I wanted to say something on that, too, because you might have realized that last year, the Nobel Prize in Economics was in half given to a climate change economist, to William Nordhaus of Yale University, for integrating climate change into the long-run macroeconomic analysis. So William Nordhaus, from the 1990s on, developed the first person to set forth an integrated assessment model, to develop an integrated assessment model. And I wanted to point out here that the Nobel Committee last year said, well, this year's laureates, including Bill Nordhaus and the economics of climate change, do not deliver conclusive answers. But their findings, what they pioneered, have brought us considerably closer to answering the question of how we can achieve sustainable economic growth. So they're explicitly saying here what Nordhaus did was pioneering, but it's not the state of the art now, and I'll show you now in a second why, and I feel a certain shame as an economist that I have to show you this, but then, you know, I wanted to make the connection to that there was this Nobel Prize given last year, and how are we meant to think about that? Now, as I told you, well, you know, maybe 1.5 degrees is optimal, but I certainly believe 2 degrees is optimal. So because you might have heard that, but this economist who wants the Nobel Prize effect claims, his model still claims, a much higher amount of global warming would be optimal. So this is at the 2007 version of this model for which there's now a Nobel Prize in economics. And you know, as I say, this is a certain shame to my profession here that this man so claims the optimal path of global warming until 2100 goes up to 3.5 degrees. And as this other mode of analysis, his model is studying how much is optimal rather than given a target, how do we get there? And so his model would even say that a low target like 2 degrees or 1.5 degrees is not optimal. So how can this be that, you know, a certain other stream of economics and then even a Nobel Prize given for this comes up with such a high number of warming would be optimal? I just have 4 points how, you know, most of my community these days would criticize this model as outdated and sort of not realistic about the dangers of climate change. But I have to leave it at that for the program of today. So here are 4 problems with this old model about how much warming is optimal. So first, for those of you to which doesn't mean anything, so it's having a high discount rate, so which is saying it places a low value on future generations. Obviously, if you assume that the future is worth little, and you know sort of the far future is worth next to nothing, then you know from that perspective, more climate change perhaps is not such a problem. It's a highly contested ethical statement, but this model takes the position that it is such that we don't put a lot of weight on the future. Second, this model has unconvincing representation of climate damages. I'll say something about that in a second. So it's not true to the latest thought about how bad climate change is going to be. And the third one is a little bit technical. I'm not going to talk about this very much. So also in this model, there's no possibility for a kind of accelerated technological change. While it's now clear that renewable technologies have been very successful in the last couple of years to drive down the costs of what it costs to put more solar and wind into the global economy. And finally, some part in which I've done a little bit of research to, the model also has a too simple climate model. It's part misrepresenting the best available climate science. Now, on the second part, to make some progress on this question, how much global warming is optimal, there's a new strand of research coming from a couple of years back that shows us how this cannot be optimal while politically, you know, the world has concluded we were meant to go to well below 2 degrees. And so there's a kind of this controversy, how do we represent the climate damages in an economic model? And the most plausible reason, I would say, why it's been so spectacularly unsuccessful in showing how severe climate change is that the damage estimations, mostly from the late 90s and early 2000s, were calibrated for only for moderate levels of warming in rich countries and in a very limited community of scholars. In fact, what I did want to stress is that there are also some of my colleagues who work on a new kind of approach, which is that they're thinking about solving this problem, how do you represent damages in an economic model from an empirical point of view, because they're studying past comparisons of warming with productivity. So you have data how past warming translated into economic productivity changes. And while this is the model of the Nobel laureate here that gives you temperature change in terms of economic losses, this is more what the kind of recent studies shows what the losses from higher temperature changes. So there's new research of the past couple of years that try to bring this research strand on how much warming is optimal in line with, you know, what a lot of other scholarly communities already believe, that we need to get to well below 2 degrees. So that was the part on how much warming is optimal. Let me now come to the part which is perhaps more politically relevant, to ask the question, what's possible rather than what's needed? I'm an economist. I study policy instruments. I study options to steer the economy in this direction. And while it's important to keep the basics strong and ask, you know, where should we be, it's also important to think about by which kind of policy instrument, which economic measures do we get there, rather than saying which kind of technology makes us optimal. So possible, well, you know, if there are any philosophers here, you might heard that the dictum that ought implies can. So, you know, if to do something, you need to be able to do it. So by possible here, I don't mean what I've just been talking about, the physical and the economic constraints, but I mean the political constraints. What's possible to get more climate change mitigation done given political constraints. And so by saying this, I have something like this in mind. Well, you know, suppose you present these charts I just had to a politician. The politician will not say, okay, now I understand what I need to do and I can just, you know, transform the energy system and not think about the political constraints here. What I mean is, in my limited experience, if I give advice to policymakers, they'll always almost tell me, well, you know, I'm concerned about the environment and I'd like to do something, but there's some part of my constituency that's in the way. They're not going to support it. And, you know, the constituency is diverse. There's industry concerns, and industry can have, you know, different forms, and it can also be low carbon, but there's also, of course, the carbon-intensive industry who does lobbying, but then there are also citizens, and many politicians are concerned about what's going to do stronger climate change mitigation to my citizens who, you know, are rich and poor, and they come from a rural background or an urban background. And so that's more sort of the kind of the politician's map, if you like, where we have to think about what are feasible options to make progress. So I'll spend the remaining 15 minutes or so talking about coming from that perspective. And here's my list of sort of the main political issues, say, in the way, what I think are in the way, you know, to deliver this, what I just showed you, the optimal mix of technologies, how we could get there. So you have international complications. You have states that are not very interested in doing more climate change mitigation because they would benefit from it. It's called free-riding behavior. You have distributional problems between the global north and the global south in the international climate change negotiations. You have national complications where, of course, you have distributional questions between the present and the future, so the young and the old, but also between the rich and the poor. And generally, you know, a lot of people make a lot of money from fossil fuel-intensive activities, so decarbonization generates losers, which are currently influential. And then there's also the problem that, just in general, the public doesn't really like a lot of new taxes or levies. And beyond these sort of more, you know, economic and strategic considerations, then you have institutional complications like lobbying or like short-sighted voters or politicians who do not properly care about improving social welfare. You know, I'm sure a number of examples came to mind here. You have general skepticism regarding that the government should intervene in the economy. You have perhaps something like a status quo bias or unsuited institutions, even if you think, you know, it can't be done in the current model of political institutions. Maybe you want something like a carbon central bank or like an independent governance authority that can dictate the government that it needs to reduce its emissions more or so. So that's my long list of the kind of political problems that are in the way to do what the economic models would tell you was optimal. And, you know, because this limited time, I focus here on economists' favorite instrument, which, you know, I also agree is the most important one, which is the idea of carbon pricing. You should levy higher prices on carbon-intensive activities, and how that's perceived by citizens and sort of the complications around that if you want to introduce higher carbon prices. And while I'll leave most of these problems untouched in this talk. So why is it then that economists recommend, pretty much any economist will recommend a carbon price as the major policy instrument to do something about climate change? You know, I'm sure if you're not an economist, that's not obvious. Why would you want to solve this problem by higher carbon prices rather than by something else? The very basic argument that economists all agree on here is that it delivers emission reductions at a low cost to society. Now, you might say that's not a very convincing criterion, but on the other hand, all sorts of political reform always happens, you know, in a broad context that there's within governments a competition for scarce resources. So if you can deliver stuff at lower cost, then it also has a higher chance of making it politically, rather than if you're saying, well, the measure is actually going to be more expensive. And economists all agree that carbon pricing delivers emission reductions at this lower cost because economic actors themselves will know best where to cut emissions. Any kind of central actor like a government wouldn't know how much it costs each individual firm to reduce emissions in this way or another way if it was regulated directly. Other instruments, like you could subsidize renewable energy or you could deliver infrastructure development on their own, are not going to be sufficient. That's another argument for the carbon price. On their own, there's this problem, which you may have heard about, the rebound effect, that might just mean other forms of carbon-intensive production or consumption are still very cheap and so will be used in some way. And the final point, why economists like carbon prices, that it generates additional tax revenue. So for the government, money is always scarce, and other ways of emission reduction do not generate additional revenue. I mean, this is particular an important argument for poor countries in which governments tend to be quite constrained at raising revenue at all for, say, basic projects like infrastructure provision or improving the healthcare system. And so taxing carbon rather than taxing labor, if you're faced with an informal economy, a large shadow market, might be a good way and an easier way for a government to raise revenue. So this is why economists recommend carbon pricing. But what do citizens think about that recommendation? You know, a climate change communicator a while ago just told me all this stuff about carbon pricing. In the ears of citizens, it really plainly sounds wrong. Climate change is about the environment. How do you translate it into your language of costs and carbon prices here? And so I was just going to make the point, I'll make that very briefly, that carbon prices mostly remain at a level that's too low. Earlier I showed you this level of, you know, we should be at $50 per ton in 2020, but most of the carbon prices you see here in the world are actually around 25% of a ton. This is the carbon tax, the carbon price that exists in the European Union. This is the European Union emission trading system, which is a carbon price, is still the most important one in the world. This is the French carbon tax, which is a little bit higher. And they're sort of the most important carbon prices in terms of the revenue they generate. So you see quite a lot of countries have introduced carbon prices, but all these carbon prices only cover about 20% of global emissions. So not only are they too low, they also don't cover too little emissions, because we should be for 2 degrees at a kind of a global carbon price. Now, there are a number of, indeed a number of emissions. So this is the range of the carbon prices where we should be for 2 degrees. This is sort of what some countries have achieved in terms of carbon prices. The other thing, I said that it's only 20%, but the other thing is actually that two countries are off the chart. So Sweden and Switzerland have a higher carbon price than is labeled on this chart here. And they're sort of more like at $100 per ton. So I haven't put them on the chart. So a few countries made it there. And so that's sort of also what I do in my research, is to think about ways to improve this picture and what stands in the way of getting higher carbon prices. So I now come to the point, what do citizens think of that recommendation? Sorry about the change. And so while, you know, to economists this is convincing, to citizens it isn't really convincing, and some of my colleagues also in Barcelona elaborated that it's basically 3 points why citizens don't find that convincing. So the first one is citizens do not really believe pricing carbon helps to reduce emissions. What the public seems to get more easily is that financing green infrastructure, like, you know, build wind farms, finance energy efficiency programs, is a popular way of reducing emissions. While, you know, the public rather than the economists are not convinced that pricing carbon will actually reduce greenhouse gas emissions. The second point is that, you know, to many people it seems a concern just that environmental taxes will harm the poor. And so this could be a problem not only for the political popularity, but, you know, if you're concerned about inequality in this context. And then the third one is that there's, on part of the citizens, there's a lot of distrust in government if the government is levying a new tax to spend that revenue well. Like, you know, the government will get some money, and would the government actually do something laudable with it? Now, what I'll do is I'll take each point in turn and say something about, you know, what have the economists to say. So has carbon pricing actually reduced emissions? The simplest example for such a lecture to show you is, so here's the United Kingdom, and the coal share of total energy generation in the United Kingdom. So Great Britain is indeed the European country that has reduced emissions most. We're now at like 45% emissions less than we were in 1990. And this shows that because they introduced an additional carbon price here in 2013, they've largely driven out their coal share in a couple of years. You know, I can't go into the details here, but so this is just one example showing you that carbon pricing is very effective. With a carbon price, Britain has killed its coal emissions in a couple of years. First point, well, no, we believe carbon pricing actually reduces emissions quite a lot. It's the most effective instrument if it is put in place. On the second one, So does carbon pricing hurt the poor people? Here's a new study from some of my colleagues. Indeed, it's true that poorer households spend a higher share of their income on carbon-intensive goods, so this is why a carbon tax in itself might harm the poor people. The poor, in relative terms, spend more. But also, richer households still spend more on carbon-intensive goods in total. So the poor spend more in relative terms, the rich spend more in absolute terms. And this is why, just the tax on carbon in itself is regressive. Yes, it will harm the poor people, but you could use the revenue, because you have these combinations of the first two points, you could use the revenue to make it progressive if you redistributed the revenue, say, on the basis that everybody gets back the same. Or you could even redistribute it in a more progressive way if you finance the transfer from the carbon tax revenue especially to the poor people, then the whole thing would reduce inequality. So that's the basic argument. And I found an illustration a couple of weeks ago. There's a new study which has the numbers for Spain in particular. So some colleagues have developed a model here to saying it's the case of a green tax reform in Spain where the revenues are redistributed in this way, so equal per capita, every person gets the same amount back. And so what's this showing is, here's the cost of the reform in terms of in blue, what is the carbon price of 40 euros per ton in some sectors of the Spanish economy is going to cost the Spanish population, where this is labeled from the poorest to the richest, right? So here, this is the 10% of the poorest, and this is the 10% of the richest. And so in blue, you see that these are the losses you'd get from a carbon price, but then in the orange, you see the net benefit. So if you redistribute the money to the poor people, if you just redistribute the money so that everybody gets back the same, then you see that the poor people actually benefit disproportionately, and it's the rich people which will pay more. So yes, there are concerns, and these concerns are real, that a carbon tax can harm the poor, but there's this way to make it progressive so that the poor can overall actually benefit. So if you're interested in the details, this is a study especially on Spain on that question. And now on the third point I had in mind, saying, there's a lot of distrust in government around will they spend the money in this way. In my research, I've looked at the relationship between the carbon prices there are and the public trust in politicians. And so while, this is suggestive, I'm not claiming statistical significance here, it suggests that carbon prices are particularly high in those countries where there's a lot of public trust in politicians. This is pretty much all the carbon prices there are around the world. You could say that France is a bit of an exception. In France, public trust in politicians is lower. But then you'll know that France had these protests last year about which are called the Yellow West. It might be a bit of an overstatement to say the Yellow West were only caused by, trust in politicians being low, but it's suggestive that there's a live issue here. On that point then, I believe what's a little bit new here in what I have to say, beyond what a standard economist would say, is that if you're thinking about carbon pricing as an efficient instrument to reduce emissions, you should prioritize what can be done to make the instrument more popular, because this is going to matter for public support. So an efficient or equitable carbon price proposal is of little use if it's not implemented in practice. And similarly, an efficient or equitable policy is of little use if it is later repealed due to public opposition. So there are examples where countries had a carbon price, and then there was a change of government, and the government abolished the carbon price again. So that's what happened in Australia a while ago. So this is what I look at. There are then a couple of things to overcome this unpopularity of a carbon price, perhaps. So if distrust in government is the issue, you should do this kind of model of a fee and dividend where you give back everybody the same amount equal per capita. If focus on inequality is an issue, a direct transfer from a carbon tax to an especially affected group might help. And if citizens are really not convinced that carbon prices are effective, then in addition, you could use the revenue for green investments. Coming to a close now, I don't want to say that carbon prices are the only thing we need to be doing. There are obviously important instruments beyond pricing that matter And which I have no time to go into. One is the clean energy innovation bit. So, you know, saying we need more carbon pricing doesn't mean we don't need any subsidies for new technologies that are low carbon. We also need low carbon infrastructure development. And one reason is that, you know, if we have more of that in place, the world's also going to need lower carbon prices from the economics of it. But on their own, this is what I want to get across, just doing these two won't be sufficient. We also need the carbon price to do an effective climate policy. So in conclusion, coming to a close, I've argued that our literature called integrated assessment models provide insight into which technological options are needed and can mitigate climate change effectively. That part of the economics of climate change shows us that continued economic growth is possible within the limits, say, of a 2 degrees target, as climate change mitigation is not especially expensive, but at the risk of using partially speculative future technologies. And the second part, I've argued that carbon prices reduce emissions effectively, they can also be designed to reduce inequality, but they're not particularly popular, and that's a major obstacle. And so what might help is to design them in combination with other instruments so that their popularity can be increased. Finally, on a not entirely serious note, but I mean it's serious in the way in which I believe my research to have some sort of impact, what I believe is possible and needed is that we think about environmental policy with a kind of an utopian pragmatism, as I've thought. So the first half of my lecture was about, say, the socially optimal utopia. And I believe you should have your policy recommendation firmly grounded in ethical positions about the world you would like to see. And you would like to see, presumably, if you hear a lot of climate change mitigation, a well below 2 degree target. On the other hand, there's this second half, which is about you also need to be pragmatic to develop the recommendations you put to the public in view of the institutions there are, the governments you're currently working with, and come up with concrete reform proposals. It's not enough to just say, well, we need more climate change mitigation because it's a bad thing. We have to think about what can concretely be done. So here I cite a well-known English author who has said that a cynic knows the price of everything and the value of nothing. And perhaps this author had in mind an economist when he said that. You know, economists typically sort of know the price of everything, the value of nothing. And that's a well-known quotation. What's less well-known is there's also a second part to this quotation, which says a sentimentalist sees an absurd value in everything and doesn't know the market price of a single thing. When I read this, I sometimes have an environmentalist in mind who doesn't get the kind of involved political trade-off. So this is a quote from Oscar Wilde, from Lady Windermere's Fan. And with that, I thank you very much for your attention.
Damos lugar ahora, evidentemente, al turno de preguntas y comentarios del público. Tenemos un micro, como siempre. ¿Alguien se anima a romper el hielo? Nunca mejor dicho. Sí, aquí delante.
I have no translation so far.
Can I do it in English?
Oh, yeah,
sure. Thank you very much for the presentation. As an economic position, I thank you, and the conclusions said that the basis of the conclusion of your work is having in mind that continued economic growth is possible. Mm-hmm. And that's not a question about you. You think that for avoiding emissions, you have not to have in mind production, I mean, a reduction of production. In an example, if us citizens could buy, you know, a car or an electric, a water machine or whatsoever, mm-hmm. which could live forever, I mean, and not be changed every 3 or 2 years mm-hmm. at least, why we do not buy a thing like that. I mean, the same is in clothes or whatsoever. Mm-hmm. So I ask myself that first question. I mean, don't we have to have in mind a reduction in production, and mm-hmm. can be not possible, or mm-hmm. the same growth mm-hmm. in economic sense mm-hmm. as we have mm-hmm. had before. Mm-hmm. And the second thing is pricing carbon and taxes on emissions has been for the first thinking on environment protection, who just pollute has to pay it. But mm-hmm. how do you have in mind, in economic mm-hmm. studies, how do we use these taxes, these mm-hmm. Prices? Mm-hmm. How do you use this, for example, in a better technologic way of cleaning, for example, the atmosphere mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. these polluted mm-hmm. emissions? Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much. Good questions. On the first one, what kind of economic growth do I mean when I say, well, the world economy will continue to grow and still reducing emissions is possible? I agree that a reduction in production will need to happen. I also agree that the sense in which there is economic growth will change. It won't be the growth we have seen before. Nevertheless, what economists have in mind when they say that is, economic value. Economic growth means a growth in economic value, and we were still meant to see a lot of economic value in the future. There's a live and real issue saying a lot of poor countries will still need to grow a lot more because we want to end global poverty too, not just deliver on climate change mitigation. And there you see a really hard political issue to say that growth that these countries in particular need must be made low carbon. So we should be worried in particular if they build more high carbon infrastructure. But say if you take Western European countries, I believe, I'm pretty positive, we'll reduce emission a lot and still have a lot of economic growth easily, because economic growth largely comes from human beings getting better at doing what they're doing. So we'll see economic growth from all of us getting better, a lot of our service jobs. On the second question, I think it's an important option to use some of the carbon price revenue for technological development. I mean, this is in particular in Europe, this is a very popular option, just because in Europe you have Europe seems particularly strong on that point, that citizens don't really like this idea of taxing carbon so much, and still we have carbon prices in Europe. And there's not so much need to do these other uses of the revenue, like cut other taxes or give it back directly. But many European countries have used some of their carbon pricing revenue to finance low carbon technologies and finance energy efficiency programs.
Más preguntas? Sí, aquí delante.
So thanks for your talk. It's very interesting. I got a couple of, in Spanish sense, two quick questions. Uh-huh. Which is the role of demography? How do you see the evolution of democracy in these projections? Because mm-hmm. we've been listening for 20 years now that Japan is not growing, but Japan looks well, and it is full of old people, and mm-hmm. they will die, unfortunately, in the next 10 years, and mm-hmm. Japan will shrink a lot. Mm-hmm. So do you think this is a factor that has to be taken into account in these projections in a positive way, maybe? Because also, the growth in the global south will most likely make a further decrease in the number of births. And secondly, how do you see the issue of inequality? Because this has been featured in your presentation, and we've been listening also in the last years, things like in the 17th century we were less unequal and things like that. And I think there's something very wrong with these considerations, because the kind of goods that we can pursue and the kind of services we have access to, sometimes even for free, has changed a lot. And so do you think that inequality should be our main concern, tax the 1%, et cetera, or we should focus on poverty? Mm-hmm. How do you see this issue in mm-hmm. more detail? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I'll try to give brief answers. So demographic projections are evidently in some of these models. It is true that, of course, a reduced population growth would make the problem easier. I'm not sure that, this is so much an issue for Japan or so, but it's certainly an issue for some of the developing world. On the other hand, I think there are a lot of good reasons not to say make demography a policy variable if we think about something that could be done to reduce climate change, and perhaps we can have that discussion later on. On the second point, obviously rising inequality is a very important topic in economic policy, and I'm doing some related research that has nothing to do with climate change. But as this is a lecture on climate policy, I think the main danger, beyond what I've argued that you can overcome some inequality concerns, is the main danger is that rising inequality seems to mean that governments have less of a maneuvering space for doing any kind of policy, because there's always the issue of inequality is increasing, which is true in Western nations, at least within the countries. And that often means governments are more constrained by what kinds of changes to society, to the economy, they can make. And this is where I see the real danger to good climate policy, but also to some other forms of good policy.
Yo aprovecharé la ocasión. Sí. Okay, let's do it in English, though. Your point about this major policy change being not more expensive than other policy reforms that have taken place in the past. As a historian, I was very interested in that. Could you further elaborate on that? Could you give examples of previous policies that whose implementation has been significantly expensive? I could think of wars, but it might not be the best example. But could you give other examples of policy changes and their costs?
So I probably need to clarify that statement slightly. So what we were saying is, think about the drastic transformation in terms of the energy system that a country like Spain needs to undergo in the next 10 years or so if we want to be on track of our emission reductions. What these models are showing, the cost of that is comparatively, say, to such a country enacting a major health reform. So it wasn't a statement about the history, the statement I made in the talk. And also this is saying, this is the cost if everything works optimally, everything works beautifully, and exactly the right things are put in place by the government. Now you'll know, and you know better than me, that this is not typically what happens, and this is not how history has played out. That said, I think what's the interesting point here is that perhaps there is something to learn from previous transformations of the society of societies, how this is going how this can be organized. And so, the one that economic historians seem to find particularly interesting here is the kind of end of slavery in the 19th century. That was a very big transition, and also one that, was not so well managed in parts, if you think about the trade system, et cetera, and so it had massive economic problems. So what this is not saying, this was why I was saying, it's map-making, it's a benchmark, it's not saying this is what's the likely outcome of the political reality, but still it's the kind of benchmark by which you should evaluate what you're doing. And perhaps a final brief remark, something I'm interested in my research is that for thinking about more climate-friendly societies, we will also think about value changes, changes in values of citizens. And there perhaps we have something to learn from spectacular cases of value changes in the 20th century, where in decades, things around, say, women's rights or things about smoking cigarettes drastically transformed. And so I think they're interesting cases for some sectors like, the future of meat consumption. Will we see mass vegetarianism very soon? It's possible. There's something perhaps to be learned comparatively. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for the talk. Really, really interesting. Maybe I missed some comments about it myself. Yeah?
Yeah.
That was very interesting in terms of how to accommodate pricing of carbon in national economies.
Yes.
Could you make some comments about how to balance this pricing of carbon in countries that do not have access to the technology? In such cases, this is not favorable for the development of these countries, obviously, and there has to be a technology transfer from the rich countries to the poor countries. So how is this incorporated in this reasoning, in these models?
It's a very important question, of course. So, this was partly for delivering a succinct lecture that, it's not only carbon pricing, you need these other policies. On the other hand, most people are astonished how really quite cheap renewable energies already are. I mean, in many parts of the world, if you're talking about the new installation, you know, if a country thinks about building more power plants, then by and large, we're in the year in which the renewable options tend to be the cheaper ones already. Like, you know, last week in the news, I read like India has cancelled an enormous amount of coal power plant developments because they're saying it's not profitable. Solar is going to be cheaper. So I think we'll come in the 2020s in a situation where we need the carbon prices largely to drive out the existing fossil fuel infrastructure. So in that sense, I think the picture is a bit more positive, as your question seemed to imply. Well, you know, a poorer country, the carbon price reduces the consumption of fossil fuel energy. What else are they going to do? I'm pretty positive that, you know, fortunately, we now live in an age where the for many sectors of the economy, the alternatives are readily available. It's true that, you know, if you think about, if you think about transport, for example, it's not all that easy. Like, you know, we're a little bit of a step away from actually making the electric car the means of mass transportation. So this was the global overview, and we have to be very careful, of course. You know, if you now ask me how do we want to design a carbon price for Colombia, we'll have a long conversation, you know, at which stage the Colombian economy is in their various sectors. But it's an excellent point, thank you.
Por si hubiera alguna duda, se pueden hacer preguntas en español, no hay problema, lo solucionamos. ¿Alguna pregunta más? Muy bien, pues, perdón, siendo la hora que es, creo que lo podemos dejar. Muchísimas gracias a Linus por una muy interesante conferencia. Vamos a tenerle con nosotros de todas maneras. Y sí, creo que se merece un aplauso, ¿verdad que sí?
Thank you very much. Very